Hello, everyone, and welcome to this Brennan Center for Justice event. For those of you joining for the first time, the Brennan Center is a nonpartisan law and policy institute that works to repair, revitalize, and defend our systems of democracy and justice. I'm Zoe Schiffer, managing editor of Platformer, an independent publication focused on exploring the intersection of democracy and technology. We're so excited to have you joining us this evening. But before we get started, I have a few housekeeping items to go over. First, we will leave time for viewer questions at the end, so feel free to add those via the YouTube and Facebook live chats. Second, and this one's critical, civility is really important to us. If you're rude on any of the chats, you will be removed from the conversation. Live closed captioning will be provided, and if you wish to follow along with the conversation on social media, please do so using the hashtag Brennan Center Live. A very big thank you also to our partner, the Georgetown University Center for Security and Emerging Technologies. Now on to today's program. Generative artificial intelligence, long the stuff of science fiction, is suddenly everywhere. From college campuses to workplace emails to social media, it's increasingly hard to decipher what's real and what is artificial. AI has arrived at a difficult time for American democracy. False claims of voter fraud are widespread. The former president is under multiple indictments for attempting to reverse his 2020 defeat, and foreign adversaries are openly interfering in US elections. Voters were already having trouble separating fact from fiction. So now the question of the evening: how will the advent of AI affect the 2024 election, the first presidential election of the generative AI era? I have some of the top authorities on this subject with me today to break all of this down. Allow me to introduce our esteemed panel of experts. First, Michaela Panditaratne, counsel for the Brennan Center Democracy Program. Thank you for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Next, Mia Hoffman, a research fellow at the Center for Security and Emerging Technology at Georgetown University.
Hi, everyone. So thrilled to be here.
And finally, Larry Norden, senior director of the Brennan Center Elections and Government Program.
Hi, everyone. Thanks, Zoe.
Good evening, everyone. Okay, let's get to some questions. Larry, you're up first. In your writing on AI and elections, you've outlined measures that election officials must take to protect election infrastructure and personnel from AI-generated threats. Can you tell us, to start off the evening, what the biggest threats are and what steps must be taken to protect against them?
Yeah, so we really looked at what the threats are to election offices, election infrastructure, and personnel. And I break it down into four categories, the threats. The first is the imitation threat. A lot of folks talking about deep fakes or the ability for ChatGPT to write articles. I see the imitation threat as both a threat to the outside world and inside in the offices. So to the outside world, there's the potential of a deep fake or some written materials to look like they're coming from election offices when they're not, undermining the credibility of the election offices. On the inside, there's the potential for fakes to, one of the things that we worry about are like phishing attacks. Somebody coming in pretending that they're a supervisor asking for confidential information or a password that might get them access to files that they shouldn't have access to. So that's the imitation threat. There's also the threat of harassment. We have seen with open records requests, election offices being inundated often with, in recent years, with frivolous questions asking for materials prevent election officials from doing their work. That's one example of something that's happened recently. You can imagine with AI that this problem just becomes a lot worse. Bruce Schneier talks about how AI can make scale, scope, sophistication of threats worse. And there's an example where you could just imagine offices being inundated with thousands and thousands of requests that keep election officials from doing their work. And then the third is more sophisticated cyber attacks potentially against election offices. A fourth one that I would add is just the fear of AI. There's been so much written about it, and there's been so much undermining of confidence in our elections already, that AI itself, the topic, claims for what it can do, may add to this undermining of confidence in elections. So those are the kind of four things that I see as threats to election offices, election infrastructure. In terms of what can be done, I think it's important to realize that we already have a lot of the solutions in place. Security experts have been talking about them for a long time. So one is we just need more resilient systems, right? So I talked about the threat of a phishing attack. Multi-factor authentication, if you require somebody, if they provide a password, that something has to go to their phone before somebody can actually access files, then you're gonna deal with that threat. If you require voting machines to have paper backups, you require electronic poll books to have paper backups, even if somebody successfully gets into a system with a more sophisticated cyber attack, they're not actually gonna necessarily prevent people from being able to vote. Relatedly, we need more resources for election offices, and we need more resiliency in the public. We need to make sure that election officials, the media, are giving the public accurate information about elections and pre-bunking the potential lies that could be told about our election systems.
Thank you so much. That was really well said. We have a surprise guest speaker here to answer that same question. Larry, before the program tonight, we used samples of your writing to train an AI language model and used samples of your interviews that allowed an AI to clone your voice and synchronize the movement of your lips on existing footage. All of these materials, by the way, were fully available online. Using all of this, we were able to get your answer to the question that I just asked you. So, AI, Larry, what are the biggest threats to election infrastructure and personnel from AI, and what steps need to be taken to protect against them?
Thank you to the Brennan Center for this discussion. It's an honor to participate. Delving into AI's impact on elections, we're seeing a complex and evolving landscape. A major concern is how AI reshapes cyber attacks, adversaries from individual hackers to countries like China, Russia and Iran are using AI for more sophisticated attacks. Posing real threats to election integrity. Deepfakes and deceptive media are another challenge. AI's capacity to create false yet realistic media can mislead the public and undermine trust in democracy. AI-driven voter suppression, spreading misinformation, especially targeting vulnerable groups, is also a critical issue, potentially influencing election outcomes. Addressing these challenges involves several key approaches. One, enhancing cybersecurity. Strengthening election systems against AI attacks is crucial, involving robust security practices like multi-factor authentication and paper backup. Two, support for election offices. Local offices need technical support and training to handle AI-related security risks, legislation and regulation. It's vital to develop laws regulating AI in elections, particularly those targeting AI-generated deceptive content, for your collaboration and public awareness. A joint effort between government, the private sector, and public education is essential with tech companies.
Okay, Larry, how do you think the AI did?
Not bad. I don't think I'm quite ready to be replaced yet, but that's actually pretty impressive.
It's disturbing to watch for sure. Well, thanks for playing ball with us. Michaela, a question for you. You've written about malicious uses of AI to misrepresent public opinion and distort policymaking. What does this look like in practice?
Yeah, so one of the things that we talk about is this episode in 2017 where bots flooded the Federal Communications Commission with more than a million comments from fake constituents as part of a rulemaking process they had, and many of the bots were urging the repeal of the commission's net neutrality rules. You know, in this instance, in 2017, the bots were using natural language processing, not generative AI, but a precursor to generative AI. And the comments that many of the bots produced were sort of uncannily similar. So they used identical sentence and paragraph structures, but would swap out words for synonyms of one another. And in part because of this kind of strange similarity of the comments, regulators and others in that instance were able to uncover this deceptive effort to undermine or subvert the policy process. But with new developments in generative AI, that task to kind of root out these efforts to distort policymaking processes and to influence decision makers and policy implementers is much more complicated, because through generative AI, you can create all of these comments that look much more varied. They really look like they come from real constituents. In fact, research does suggest that policymakers at the state level generally can't distinguish between human-authored communications and AI-generated communications that seem to stem from legitimate constituents. And with newer versions of generative AI tools that are getting better all the time, that, you know, makes this distinction even more opaque. So this is relevant, of course, in the rulemaking process. It's relevant in the process of formulating legislation, but of course it's true in the elections context as well. So the ability to understand the will of constituents and interested stakeholders, to really understand public sentiment, is critical for policymakers, and it's especially critical for election officials. And, you know, as Larry mentioned, there's been a lot of attention in deepfakes, but the use of kind of the technology underlying generative AI chatbots, so the large language models, has received relatively less attention when it comes to elections and the information environment. So in the election context, there is the risk that deceptive actors will use language models to kind of field content to election officials that maybe creates the false impression that baseless doubts about election integrity are more prevalent than they are, to distract election officials. They might sort of use language models to game social media platform recommendation algorithms so that false election narratives trend or are boosted by the platform's recommendation algorithms. So this does pose, you know, a very significant challenge. And even though we can sort of mitigate it, it's not one that is easily kind of fully rectified.
Yeah, absolutely. Of the threats and distortions that you just described, which one are you the most worried about?
You know, I think that social media platforms are going to be a very significant vector for a lot of the content, both the deepfakes and also the content from language models. And in some ways, the content from language models is going to be less sort of immediately visible and pose a kind of different risk factor. And so that is something that I think is relatively underexamined and could kind of pose a significant challenge for elections.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much for that. Mia, the United States seems to be struggling for the best way to regulate AI. You've studied the EU AI Act and what it could possibly mean for regulation in the rest of the world. Can you break down that act for us and tell us specifically what the EU deemed dangerous enough to regulate?
Yeah, so I'll start with a disclaimer because the negotiations for the EU AI Act are still ongoing, so it hasn't been finalized and they're pretty heated at the moment. So some of the details that I'm gonna be talking about might not be as accurate anymore in a few weeks, we'll see. But the core of the framework will definitely stay at the core of the regulation. It's based on this risk-based approach, which kind of takes into account the level of risks of different use cases of AI that they pose to the health and safety and fundamental rights, so democratic norms of people. And the higher the associated risk of an AI system's use case, the more stringent the regulation that is going to be associated with this. At the top of this hierarchy are essentially systems that are considered to pose unacceptable risks. They're going to be prohibited. This includes, for instance, the most facial recognition in public spaces, which is considered a pretty strong infringement on civil rights and democratic liberties. But the bulk of the regulation really deals with these high-risk AI systems, so the use cases that are considered to be very sensitive and that are going to be subject to a range of requirements and obligations. And many of these categories are still subject to debate, but broadly, they include categories of use cases that are kind of intuitively risky. So AI systems being used to administer public benefits or healthcare, AI systems being used in law enforcement or for border management, for instance. And most critically for our discussion today, AI systems being used in the administration of democratic processes, which includes AI systems being used in electoral processes for vote counting or voter registration, et cetera. So somebody who wants to develop an AI system that's going to be used in that context then has to come comply with like a bunch of different requirements. They have to address questions regarding the quality of the training data. They have to demonstrate that their system meets certain performance standards when it comes to the accuracy, but also unbiasedness and the security, of course, of the system. Lorraine mentioned that kind of AI introduces new security risks. This is something, a component that they will have to demonstrate. There are pretty extensive risk management processes that require testing and evaluation. So a bunch of requirements that deal with how AI systems for this type of use are going to be developed. There's a second set of requirements that actually looks at how these systems are going to be used, so that target kind of the deployer, which in this case would be election offices, and that look at monitoring requirements, kind of record keeping and logging in case something goes awry, that there is traceability that goes back to it. And of course, kind of incident reporting. So when something goes wrong, that there's this kind of accountability framework. So the latest wave of AI systems that we kind of talk about that came about last year is generative AI that you mentioned in the introductions, obviously don't really fit very neatly into this category. They don't have a predetermined use case. They can be used in a lot of different contexts. How these will be regulated is actually currently very, very unclear because opinions go diverge in the EU institutions. I think what will be clear is that there's going to be some requirements for content labeling, transparency requirements when it comes to people interacting with this AI system. They should be aware they're interacting with the AI system. But what exactly that will look like is not yet decided.
Got it. Okay. Well, we'll be curious to watch as this plays out. What might this framework look like if it was implemented in the United States?
That is a really great question. I think we're all aware here that the kind of approach to tech regulation in the EU and the US has been very systemically different. The US has just historically taken a more pro-innovation approach that looked more at technological leadership. The EU is a technology importer, more broadly speaking, so they are more concerned with the impact of others' technology on their market and their citizens. But I will say that I think there has been quite a shift in the policy discussion in the US over the past year. I think this release of ChatGPT has really brought AI to the attention of everybody, and there's quite a bit of momentum in Congress too, among policymakers everywhere, to do something about this. So based on these discussions, I think if the US were kind of to implement like a US AI Act, I think it would focus more strongly on these generative AI systems, on these more advanced AI systems. and mostly on kind of the potential for them being used for really nefarious purposes. Disinformation is obviously a big topic of discussion, but also things like cyber attack, like Larry mentioned, these are really priorities for policymakers. And I think this would be something that US policymakers will be focusing on for regulation.
Okay. Well, given how tech regulation has gone in this country, I won't hold my breath, but it's still good to understand. Okay, I have a few questions that I want to get everyone's take on. So first off, 2 weeks ago, was it just 2 weeks ago, the Biden administration introduced an executive order establishing new standards for AI safety and security. Do you think this is enough oversight or is more needed for this technology? And maybe, Mia, we can start with you and then go around.
Sure. So I think the executive order, so more like at a high level, I think it does a lot of things right. I think they're trying to address a lot of different concerns with one directive, and that's hard to do. In terms, just in the context of elections, I think there are two main buckets that it seems to be addressing. The first is really the disinformation bucket, with doing research on watermarking techniques. So this idea that kind of hidden patterns are going to be embedded in AI-generated content, so that it will be detectable and identifiable, and we can actually tell what information, what media is real and what's fake. And the second, and this is actually the part that I'm even more excited about, is investments in research into authentication technology. Simply because being able to tell that some information has not been manipulated might actually become more valuable than being able to tell if something has been AI generated or not, because it just requires kind of trustworthy issuers of news to be able to comply with this authentication rather than making everybody who generates something with AI use watermarking. So they're using this, they're going to implement this authentication methodology in their communication from the government to constituents. This is going to become mandatory, which I think is very valuable. It just increases the government as a more, the trust in the government communication to its constituents. It becomes a more reliable source that way. So I think this is a really great step. I hope they will get to that level of effectiveness of these methodologies soon enough. That's of course hard to predict, but I think this is a really good start. The second thing that I really like is that election hardware and software is part of critical infrastructure in the U.S. and is, because of the executive order, now subject to an annual risk assessment when AI is being used there, including subject to the NIST AI risk management framework process. This is a terrific resource. The NIST framework is, in my opinion, the gold standards for risk management out there, and making compliance with this process mandatory is a really good start.
Thank you so much, Mia. Michaela, do you want to go?
Sure. I'll just sort of add a footnote to one of the things that Mia mentioned around the content provenance standards. We know that those potential standards will only be required to be used for federal agencies, which is, you know, sort of the inherent limitation of a current executive action on this front. And we do also know that you know, state and local election offices are, in many cases, the ones that are administering elections at a practical level. And so it will be really sort of critical to see states and localities take action there, hopefully with swift sort of guidance and sensible guidance from the federal government. You know, I think absent congressional action, there's sort of a modest amount that can be done and made enforceable by the federal government, and we kind of saw that with the order. So, given those constraints, I do think it's an admirable effort. It sort of got creative by invoking a national security law, the Defense Production Act, to create kind of a hook for modest reporting requirements. And, you know, the government can also as I mentioned, impose requirements for the use of AI by its own agencies, and that's envisaged by the order. But when you look at what's enforceable, it's a very small portion of items. And sort of elements like voter suppression, the use of AI in election administration, election security aren't expressly recognized. So, you know, as the order is implemented, there are certainly important steps that need to be taken to ensure that those elements are sufficiently protected, but much more is needed by Congress as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Larry, do you have anything to add?
I just think it's worth emphasizing the last point that Michaela was making, which is, you know, there's only so much that you can do with an executive order. It's not legislation. You don't have the power of the purse, so you can't fund things, and you can't just make law. Most of what you're doing through an executive action, an executive order, is telling federal agencies what to do. And there's a lot of really good stuff here that Mia detailed. That hopefully will spread from the federal government to society at large. And that's a really important first step. And, you know, there are things where the Biden administration pushed a little bit further, because it could, as Michaela said, under the Defense Production Act, actually putting in some requirements for people that are, for developers that are developing really advanced AI systems. And as Mia said, there's this one piece, and we'll just have to see what happens with it, but critical infrastructure that the federal government has can do a lot more with, and that includes our election infrastructure. And we'll just have to see. I mean, this is an extremely ambitious executive order. As I said, they can't fund themselves. The deadlines are really short, and there's a lot that, you know, we'll just have to see what they do with it. But I have to say, given the limited powers that the administration has without Congress, I think we should be commending them for what they did.
Yeah. Okay, one more for the whole group. One of the biggest questions we have right now surrounds not the election itself, but the aftermath, with so many people still believing that the last presidential election was somehow tampered with and therefore not valid. What might election subversion of this kind look like in the AI era? And Michaela, maybe we can begin with you.
Sure. You know, so we might see sort of amplification of false narratives about the election process, you know, potentially deep fakes of election officials manipulating the vote count or preventing people from voting. That's something, you know, that we should be worried about potentially seeing. The use of generative AI could be exploited to spoof election websites on a larger scale. We know that spoofing without the use of generative AI has occurred in prior elections and can be used to potentially pass on misleading and deceptive content about election administration to voters. So that's something we need to watch out for. And then also sort of the use of AI to facilitate voter challenges and voter purges is again a potential risk that we need to be looking out for. So in the lead up to the 2022 midterm elections, we did see misguided groups of citizens combing through voter rolls and other sources of data, performing sometimes faulty and error-prone analyses to try to eject voters from the registration rolls and undermine faith in the integrity of the elections. In some cases, they were mobilized by very well-funded and coordinated groups. And we also know that there is at least one AI tool that activists are now being trained on to perform a similar function. And so, you know, with that tool, with potential new tools, we may see increased numbers of voter challenges. And as a consequence of that, potentially increases in purges in 2024 or beyond.
Okay, thank you for that. Mia, do you wanna go next?
Sure, so very much agree with what Michaela said. I think one thing I'm increasingly worried about, which is kind of, I guess, a little bit of a side effect of everybody getting very buzzed about generative AI and learning about it and being aware of it, is that people are becoming more aware that disinformation is a problem, and at the same time will become less trusting of even authentic media, essentially questioning, are my news real? Is this image, video, audio actually true, or is somebody trying to manipulate me? So I think there's this risk of people becoming, in one way, good at scrutinizing what they see, and on the other hand, like this rise and false positive, just like losing credibility of authentic information. And this can, of course, this momentum can kind of be exploited, right? Somebody, political candidates, for instance, can claim that some point or piece of evidence brought forward by journalists or the other side can claim that that's actually AI manipulated or AI generated and not real, continue just to muddy the water of the debate and reduce the credibility of actual information. This is something I do worry about, and I think that is new now that everybody is so over aware of generative AI.
Yeah, absolutely. Larry, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, one thing to do is to look. I mean, we're going to have many elections before the U.S. election since this kind of explosion of generative AI. So one place to look is what's been happening in other countries as they've been having elections in the last couple of months. And I think we should be looking ahead, because often what happens is you see things first in other countries and then it comes to the U.S. So one thing I'm concerned about is some kind of October surprise. We've actually had those in recent elections, but we saw in Slovakia leaked audios right before the election. They were fake of one of the leading candidates, you know, and it had him saying that he was going to increase taxes on beer. There was another one that said he was going to rig the vote. I wouldn't be surprised if we see something like that or things like that circulating on social media in just a couple of days before the election. I'm worried post-election, right? When you're talking about subversion, in 2020, after a 2020 election, you had these memes on social media claiming that the poll workers, Shay Moss and Ruby Freeman, who were slandered and defamed, you had some memes on social media with them saying some kind of outrageous things. That would have been so much worse if there was a deep fake of them doing something inappropriate. So those are, you know, when I think about what am I worried about, I look back to things that have happened in previous elections and how they could be made worse or kind of what we're seeing now with elections. The good news, I suppose, if there's any good news in all of this, is that we can prepare for a lot of these things, right? All the things that we're talking about in some sense aren't new. It's just that that they could be more extreme. They could be coming at us more quickly.
Yeah. Okay, Larry, a question for you. Which states, if any, are getting regulation right? And do you think across the board, this threat is being taken seriously enough by election officials?
I don't think there's any question that election officials are taking this seriously. In terms of, and you know, I one of the things that I want to emphasize, and I said this a little bit, but in terms of how election offices should be preparing for this, is they really need to double down on the things that security experts have been recommending for them ahead of time. And I think they're doing that. So the good news is we have paper ballots almost everywhere in the United States, right? Election officials have been moving to ways that's easier for them to authenticate their communications. Making sure that their websites are on .gov. They've been getting verified on social media. We need to make sure that they're doing more of that and that all election offices are doing that. But I don't think there's any question that they're taking it seriously. In terms of, you know, states are the laboratories of democracy. That's a bit of a cliched statement, but states really are out ahead of the federal government in thinking about regulation of AI. And that's true in elections too. A number of states have passed laws already, I think six states have, that deal with deepfakes in the political context and the election context. That includes Michigan has a pretty good law that they just passed, but California, New Jersey, Minnesota, Texas, it's not a, it's actually interesting, one of the few areas where there's not necessarily a Republican, Democratic position, right-left position. And that makes me a little bit hopeful. Even in Congress, we've seen there are four Republicans and four Democrats on deepfake bills. One thing I will say is There's been so much focus, and this is not surprising, on the part of legislators around deep fakes that could be used in political ads, because that really impacts them. But as our discussion today, right now, as we've been talking about, it's not just deepfakes that we have to be worried about when we're thinking about AI and elections. There's so many other areas that we should be thinking about: voter suppression, how AI is used in election administration, many others, and those really haven't been as much of a focus yet in the states.
Yeah, thank you for that. And one more for you before we jump to audience questions. Given that 2024 is just a month away, it's hard to believe. Do you feel like we're out of time for addressing the situation before it becomes a major problem for the upcoming election?
Oh, absolutely not. We do have time. You know, whether or not we can pass legislation that is going to solve all the concerns that we have around AI, that I think it's probably too late. Although I think we should still be thinking about regulation and legislation around AI. But in terms of, you know, is there time to deal with it? Absolutely there is. And again, I would go back to the fact that, you know, and Bruce Schneier said this, I butchered it a little bit before, but that when we think about the threats of AI, its scope, scale, sophistication, and I'm missing one of the S's, oh, speed. So it's like threats more in degree than in kind, certainly for 2024, I would say. And we've thought about a lot of the things that we have to do to address threats like disinformation over the past few years, because it's not like that is new. Educating the public about AI and what it is, making sure that they have accurate information about how our elections run, all of those things are things that we need to be doing over the course of this year, so that if there are attempts to sway an election using AI, that the media is prepared, and that as much as possible the public is prepared and are more resilient to abuses of AI.
Yeah. Okay, it looks like we have tons of audience questions, so let's get into some of those. The first one is, oh, and I was wondering about this too. How do we distinguish real candidate content from AI content? And these aren't specific to any one person, so I can call people individually if that's easy, or if you just want to pipe up, that's fine too.
I'll jump in. I think going back to the source, understanding where it's coming from, is a really good start. The second thing is, especially if it's very controversial, trying to question who has an interest in having this published and where is this coming from, who is sharing this, et cetera, are really good, good practices. Ideally, and this is my wish for a voluntary commitment, is going to be that political candidates, for instance, label their own AI generated content as being such, or the other way around, because I think if people adopt these types of best practices, there's just going to be more transparency towards constituents. But scrutinizing sources is the best way to go at this point.
Okay. That's great. And Larry or Michaela, do you have anything to add?
I totally agree with what Mia said. And again, in this sense, this isn't new. It's just that the problem is more extreme, right? It's not like we haven't had fake videos or other things like that in recent elections. It's just that it may become easier and it's available to a wider audience. The only thing that I would add to what Mia said is, campaigns may be able to do more, and they may end up doing more to authenticate their own communications, to so that the public can see, like, this legitimately came from a candidate, right? The only issue with that, and I think they should be doing that, is that there's a public education component to that, and it's not, watermarking things as from a campaign or doing other things that make clear that it's coming from the original source. Like, if the public doesn't know how to take advantage of it, then it's not going to mean all that much.
Yeah. Michaela, is there anything you want to add, or should we move?
I think we can move on.
Okay. Wow, juicy questions from the audience. They did a great job. What values should we embed in AI and who should decide them? Do you want to take that one, Michaela, because you didn't speak last time?
Sure. So we've thought about this in the context, this is not specific to elections, but it is relevant to sort of all processes of democracy and public comment on public policies and implementation of those policies. There is sort of potential sort of use of AI to analyze and aggregate public comment, and that could potentially sort of help policymakers and officials field the large volume of comments that they get from the public and potentially better account for them. But it's really critical in these democratic processes to guard against bias that includes racial bias and disability bias and all other kinds of bias against, especially against marginalized groups, to ensure that systems are fit for their purpose, to ensure that they're reliable, and to ensure that the use of these kinds of systems, both in that kind of democratic process, but also in the use of AI in election administration, is transparent. So we're really explaining to people, to constituents, to voters, exactly how AI systems are being used, and that there is accountability. So that there, is an opportunity where systems are affecting, for example, the right to vote, that voters have the opportunity to kind of contest that determination.
Yeah, absolutely. Larry or Mia, would you like to go? We can also move on.
I thought that was a great answer. I'll just add one small thing, which is in all of this, personal privacy is so important, right? And consumer privacy, people using AI, how their information when they use AI is being used against them is any of these things that we're talking about, that is a critical component. And I do think that ensuring that there, it is easier for people to protect their own information when they're using AI or when they are interacting with AI is critical.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'll just jump in just to close in terms of who should decide the values that are embedded. And I think this is a really important question because currently the ones who are deciding are not democratically appointed officials. The producers of these types of systems tend to be also, the tech industry suffers from a huge lack of diversity, both gender, also race, socioeconomic, religious, et cetera. And that has consequences, even if it's not intended, right? So the values that they embed, the perspectives that are embedded in systems are also reflect this lack of diversity. And I think this is something to really consider when we come to talk about regulating AI, is that democratic processes have a potential to embed these values, to safeguard these values in the AI systems that are going to be used.
Yeah, okay. Thank you all so much. Next question from the audience. What defenses do we have against the use of AI? Larry, do you want to start us off with that?
Well, I think I've said this before, but I do. One of the best defenses is literacy around AI, understanding what AI is, understanding how it works, and understanding how to authenticate, how to make sure when you're getting information that it's accurate, and the ability to take a step back, even if something really hits you emotionally, and say, wait a second, I'm gonna double check if this is actually accurate information, and I know how to do that. To me, that's probably the biggest defense there is. I should say, when we think about things like cybersecurity, AI can be a defense against AI, right? And a lot of the things that we're talking about, AI can be a defense against AI. We can use it. In this conversation, we're very much thinking about AI, and for good reason. We're thinking about the bad purposes that it can be used for, but AI can be used for a lot of good purposes too, including to be able to respond to more sophisticated cyber attacks that are created by AI.
Yeah. Hello, Armia, would you like to answer that?
Michaela, please go.
Oh, sure. I mean, one thing I'll mention is that, you know, in the 2022 midterm elections, the Brennan Center had a team of analysts that conducted analysis of posts related to the election process on major social media platforms. So they read through thousands of posts and conducted an automated analysis of tens of thousands of posts. And one of the things that we found that is very much consistent with the work of other disinformation scholars is that election deniers aren't necessarily reinventing the wheel over time. There are these core false narratives about the election process that repeat and recur. And when sort of incidental glitches that are quickly resolved occur in elections, they tend to be filtered through these core false narratives. One thing we know about generative AI is that it is most effective when it's being asked to produce content that resembles the content in its training databases. So, you know, to some extent, we can predict that some of the false narratives that will take root and travel in the next election will be the same ones that have taken root and traveled in prior elections. And that, you know, should give, even though that's troubling, it should give some comfort as well to election officials who can have the time to preempt and pre-bunk those core false narratives, give voters information about existing election security safeguards, create crisis communication plans that draw on what they can, you know, predict will occur, and, you know, establish networks of contacts with press outlets, with candidates of all affiliations, with community groups, so that information can get out quickly on election day.
Yeah, thank you. Nia?
I both agree with what both Larry and Michaela said. One thing I'll add is that, reiterate maybe, a lot of the issues, especially around disinformation, aren't necessarily new. These are problems and risks we've been dealing with since at least 2016, I think, was a major wake-up call in that respect. And a lot of the tried and trusted methods should still apply here, particularly when it comes to the distribution of this disinformation. So content moderation, fact-checking on social media platforms, as well as the identification detection of disinformation campaign, are methodologies that still apply here and would require larger investments of these companies into their kind of integrity teams, into their safety teams, which unfortunately have seen kind of a cut in the past year in many places. But these are the bottleneck that we often see for disinformation is not necessarily its creation, but its consumption. And just because there's going to be more fake news sort of out there doesn't necessarily mean that more people are going to consume them. So how it is distributed is a real big factor that social media platforms have the power to affect if they choose to do so.
Yeah, well said. I think we covered this a bit in my last question for Larry, but an audience question is, how prepared are officials for AI at this moment? And maybe we can just speak to that more overtly. Larry, because you talked about this, do you want to go first?
Look, election officials have had to deal with a lot over the past few years. And that includes, you know, as I think a lot of people who are watching will know, threats of physical violence, death threats, a very hostile work environment over the past few years. And so much so that the Brennan Center estimates that in 2024, one in four election officials will be new. So election officials they have to deal with a lot to be prepared for elections generally, cyber attacks, physical threats, a hostile environment, Now they have to be prepared for AI as well. I do think there's a lot of discussion around AI. Groups of election officials that are meeting to conduct tabletop exercises so they can prepare scenarios for various AI threats. So they're definitely thinking about all this. I wish election officials had more resources so they could be prepared to combat every threat that they face. But it's a really resilient group. It's a really committed group. So I'm optimistic that election officials will be able to handle what they are likely to face in the coming year, including from AI.
Thank you for that. Mia, do you have anything to add?
No, I think Larry said it really well. One thing I'll do, so I'll go for a shameless plug. We have a paper forthcoming on with recommendations for election officials who are implementing AI systems with some steps that they can take to mitigate some of the risks that we've been talking about. So stay tuned and read our paper.
Cool. And Michaela, do you want to say anything before we move on?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think, you know, that paper does have very useful, practical steps that that officials can take, especially when they are approached by AI vendors and they're potentially implementing AI systems in their own practice of election administration. One of the things that is not necessarily AI specific that we have talked about for a while is, you know, the fact that many election offices are not currently on a .gov domain, which does kind of strengthen the ability to have voters trust in the information that is being provided by the election office. And, you know, that's a process that is made simpler and easier by federal government support. And it's a straightforward step that election offices can take to be better prepared ahead of the 2024 election.
Yeah, amazing. Thank you. Mia, this is a question for you. Can you expand on the Biden AI executive order? What does it do and what does it not do?
Oh, do we have a few hours? This is a great question. It does a lot of different things. It addresses, I think for me, when I read it, it felt like it married the AI blueprint for an AI Bill of Rights that the White House issued a little over a year ago with these voluntary commitments that the White House secured from some of the big tech companies this summer. Because it tries to kind of bridge both questions of algorithmic accountability and fairness for consumers and citizens, as well as these threats that more advanced AI systems are posing or are going to pose or expected to pose in particular. There are a number of chapters that deal with safety and testing and standards for AI systems, which deal in particular with risks associated with these advanced systems, particular cyber threats, biosecurity, with some mandatory disclosure requirements, which are great. So companies will have to share about their efforts of developing AI systems, the methods they use to test and evaluate risks. And there are going to be some standards to assess and be able to compare them. These are great starts. And there are a number of other chapters that really deal with some questions of algorithmic fairness and accountability, in particular when it comes to the use of AI in the government and the administration of public services. Because of some of the limitations that Larry mentioned, for many of the a lot of these, what we would consider sensitive use contexts, I guess, like AI being used in recruitment and hiring outside the federal government, of course, the executive order doesn't really have the power to mandate any kind of standards. And so it encourages agencies to wield the power that they have in order to regulate the use of AI and oversee the use of AI in their districts. This is, of course, falls short of actually enforceable additional enforceable powers to mitigate some of these risks, but is a good reminder for some of the FTC, the EEOC, who have been doing a lot to address AI risks in their sectors for a while. I could go on for quite some time. So I'll just highlight one last thing that I'm very excited about in the executive order, which is addresses the use of AI systems in healthcare, which deals in particular with failure of AI system and kind of the consequences that are very real for people's lives. And it establishes an incident reporting and an assurance mechanism, basically, that ensures that when an AI system is used to make decisions about healthcare, about treatment for a patient, and it does so and it has negative consequences, that this incident will be reported, it will be shared. Everybody who uses AI systems can learn from this, which is a really good way to start improving our risk mitigation strategies. I'll stop there. I'm happy to talk for hours about the executive order, but I think we want to cover some other stuff as well.
Okay, yeah, I wanted time for just one last question. This is for all of our wonderful panelists. What is one thing that you want our audience to walk away with this evening? And Michaela, let's start with you.
I think that, the idea that many of these challenges, maybe not all of them, but many of them have been pre-existing, and that there are these kind of longstanding best practices about, as Mia mentioned, sort of verifying sources and, checking that where you're getting information from is sort of authoritative. I think that, in some ways the landscape has transformed, but it is, in some ways it is more of the same. And so sort of drawing on the toolbox that has, allowed us to persist thus far is going to get us some way up the road to the next election.
Thank you so much. Larry, do you want to go next?
Yeah. Michaela kind of stole my answer too, but I guess I'll put it slightly differently. A lot of the threats that we're talking about from AI to democracy are threats that we've been talking about for a while. It's just that AI, and I said this before, but really the threat becomes more extreme, it becomes potentially faster and more amplified. So whether we're talking about disinformation, we didn't talk at all about gerrymandering, but AI could potentially make gerrymandering and elections worse, voter suppression, all of the various things that have been threats to our democracy for some time, cybersecurity are potentially made worse by AI, but we do have solutions to those problems. We just haven't really acted on them. And one thing I am hopeful is that the realization that these threats are even greater, are on steroids, as some people have said, because of AI, should increase the urgency for starting to adopt those solutions. We can't kind of look past some of the very real problems in our democracy much longer, and this should be a call to action for all of us. And ultimately, in a democracy, it's the people, not the tech, that have the power. And we do have the power to kind of fix some of these things. That when we're talking about threats from AI, it's really AI exploiting the vulnerabilities that were pre-existing.
Thank you so much. And Mia, can you close us out?
Larry, these were wonderful final words. I have very little to add, so I'll just say this. I think the next year, it's going to be a little bit bumpy for sure. I think a lot of, like we said, the risks landscape has kind of heightened a little bit and have become a little bit more complex. There is a lot that can be done already. And I think people need to understand that there's never going to be this one policy or one regulation or one guidance that is going to solve all our problems. This is going to be an iterative process. We need a lot of different kind of approaches and guidance and regulatory involvement and policy actions to address all of these risks. And it's going to take more than one big step to actually get this right. But there is a lot that we already know and that we can do. And if we stick to those practices, I'm not entirely pessimistic that it's going to go over pretty okay.
Not entirely pessimistic and going over pretty okay, I think is a good note to end on. Thank you to our audience for all of your wonderful questions. I truly wish we had time to get to them all. Thank you again to our partner and co-sponsor for this event, the Georgetown University Center for Security and Emerging Technologies. We look forward to seeing you at future events. And if you want to find out about them, please sign up for the events newsletter at brennancenter.org/events. Once again, I'm Zoe Schipper, Managing Editor of Platformer. Thank you all for coming. Good night.